beautifully lived. We thank God for this celebration of life. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Amen. So we're going to still give a couple minutes more for those that are going to come to view, and we'll commence after that. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We magnify you, Lord. We magnify you. To God, there's love in the room. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We give honor to the Spirit of the living God on tonight. Amen. We thank God for Jesus. Thank God for his promise. I believe his promise, don't you? Amen. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. So that doesn't end here. Glory to God. It starts here. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're looking forward. This is not just a fantasy. Hallelujah. Or a dream. This is reality. And we thank God because we will see our sister one more time again for all eternity. Thank you for coming out tonight. Thank you for supporting. In Jesus' name, bless God Almighty. Hallelujah. So just to remind you about the guidelines as far as your mask on, I see everyone pretty much has your mask on, except us up here. Glory to God. And the social distancing, we just want you to keep it in mind just so that we can have safety. You know. Well, instead of 3 feet, maybe 3 inches. I don't know. Bless the Lord. Glory to God. Amen. I know we're going to be all right. Hallelujah. Don't you believe that? Amen. Amen. We thank God. Hallelujah. This time we're going to go and we're going to have our prayer. Amen. And our Pastor Holly Chowty will come before us to pray in the name of Jesus. Bless the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Somebody say praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God is good. God is good. God is great. Let's all stand as we give him glory. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be the name of the Lord. We worship you, Heavenly Father, for you are God alone and there is no one else beside you. We say thank you, Lord, because great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, because you have done great things whereof we are glad. We trust in your omniscience, Lord. We trust in your omnipotence, Lord. And so you have done, O God, according to your wisdom. And we say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, tonight we are gathered in your name to celebrate a beautiful life. We are gathered in your name, most of all, to celebrate your goodness. You, O God, you have been faithful to us. And you took home this beautiful lady. You took her to be in your presence, God. God, you took a wife. You took a mother. You took a daughter, a sister. Yes, Lord, a niece, a friend, a cousin, a relative, God, you took her in your time. And we say thank you, Lord, because you do it all things well. And today, oh God, even as we mourn, may we mourn with hope. May we mourn with a heart understanding that you are God and thy will be done. And so today, as we celebrate, dear Father, Set our spirits free to worship you. Set our tongues free to celebrate you. Set our hearts free to lift you up. Set our entire being free, Lord God, to say thank you, Jesus, for you do it all things well. Be thou glorified in this service. Lord God, I pray that out of death may come life. May someone find you as Lord and Savior. We understand, Lord, the question is being asked, how soon? Why so early? Yes, Lord, because you do all things well. And in your providence and your wisdom, you took this young woman at her age because her work was complete. And so, God, today I pray that each one of us will take stock of our lives. As your word reminds us that we should number our days, that we should apply our hearts unto wisdom. Oh God, many have knowledge, but they don't have the wisdom. But today I pray that even as we go through this time of celebrating this life, that we will all reflect in our lives and what we are doing. We would all reflect in our lives and what we're going to leave behind. Tonight, God, save someone, deliver someone, set some captive soul free, and may you be glorified in all we say and do. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I gotta behave. Amen. Bless the Lord. We thank God for every mixed emotion, the tears, the joy, glory to God, all mixed up in one room, bless the Lord. We know that when you cut a vein, it bleeds, amen, and we do bleed, hallelujah, but God is our clotting factor, so we trust God to just take us through and take the family through especially. We want to give honor to the angel of this house, our Pastor Paul B. Mitchell. Praise God, hallelujah, and his precious wife, our Pastor Yasmin Mitchell. Hallelujah. We thank God for allowing us to have this time here tonight to accommodate everyone. Want to let you know also that in case you have not gotten a program, there's a SKU in the back. You can scan the QR code with your phone and with the SKU in the lobby. And you can have a keepsake on your phone in case the programs run out, because there's quite a few people, amen, and only a certain amount of programs. But you can do this with modern technology, thank God. You can have that keepsake for you in Jesus' name. Bless the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And these beautiful people you see coming up is the praise team here at CLCC. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And they will be singing to the glory of God. We thank God for our musicians on tonight. Thank God. Hallelujah. Amen. And don't sit too long. Praise God. The spotlight is on you. Oh, yes, amen. Amen. So we're going to receive the praise team now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Worship the Lord this evening. In the midst of our trials, He is still good. He is still worthy of the glory and honor. And he is worthy of all the praise. So, Father, in spite of our loss, in spite of our grief, we still lift you up. Hallelujah. So let's worship him, saints. Give him a sacrifice of praise.
Draw me close to you.
You say that I'm your friend.
You are my
we continue to worship you, Lord. We offer you that sacrifice of praise.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. 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 So God. Hallelujah. Oh, my man. Glory to God. Wonderful Savior. Oh, my God, my God. All right, all right. All right, all right, all right. Woo! Hallelujah, Jesus. To your name, Lord, we glorify you tonight. Hallelujah. You're worthy of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise belongs to you, oh God. Son of all God, we magnify your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. All right. All right. All right. Amen. We thank God for the CLCC praise team. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. For our musicians, praise God, and for the song of worship that God went up to the throne of God. Hallelujah. We thank God. At this time, we're going to be having our scripture reading. Hallelujah. And our sister Candace Ross will be coming to read the scripture in your hearing.
God is worthy. Amen. The scripture reading from tonight is taken from Psalms 91, verses 1 to 7, and I'll be reading from the King James Version. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snares of the fowler, and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and underneath his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flies by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come near thy dwelling. May God bless the reading of his most holy word.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. We are blessed in Jesus' name. Glory to God. At this time, we're going to have a tribute, amen, by our pastor, David Frazier. Hallelujah. Let's say amen as he comes. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good. And all the time, God is good. To my dear brother, namesake, Pastor David, to the mother and father of our dearly departed sister and the children, siblings, this is for you today. The grace of God is what you need in an hour like this. And it's the grace of God that will carry you through. Nothing else but God's grace. For His strength is made perfect in our weakness. He giveth more grace when the burdens grow greater. He sendeth more strength when the labor increase. To added affliction, He added His mercy. To multiply trials, His multiplied peace. His love has no limit. His grace has no measure. His power has no boundary, known unto man. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when we our strength have failed, ere the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's forgiven is only begun. God's love has no limit. His grace has no measure. His power has no boundary, known unto man. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again. Would you join me in the chorus, God's love? God's love has no limit. His grace has no measure. His power has no boundary, known unto man. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth.
Bless the Lord. Amen. What a celebration. We thank God. Hallelujah. For our, amen. Our minister, Frazier, bless the Lord. Hallelujah. And this time, we're going to have a scripture reading once more from our, from Damali Lewis. Amen. Let's say amen.
Good. Tonight I'll be reading from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and that to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing.
The word of the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We live by it. Amen. Reflections. Praise God. And we have a number of young ladies to come before us now. Sister Natalie Lessie, Sister Dale Matthias, Sister Beverly Frazier, Miss Kimberly Anderson, and the granddaughters, Naya, Maya, and Jewel Rose. Ross, I'm sorry. Thank you, Lord.
Good night, everyone, and welcome. When I met Leslyn, I was 18 years old. Could you imagine that? Yes, I was. I was 18 years old when I met Leslyn. She came to Trinidad for the first time. And that was an experience that changed my life for a lifetime. I was 18 years and going to school and working. And on the day I met Leslyn, she said, in her voice that she uses to me, "Oh my God, that is so wonderful that you are working and you're going to school." And she said something to me that was so profound. She said, "One day you will come to America. And when you come, I will be there waiting for you." That blew my mind. But she planted a seed. She planted a seed that's stood with me all through my life. And one day I was sitting and I said, "Is she crazy? I could go to America. I don't even have a visa. I don't even have a passport." But that seed that she planted stayed with me. And the day I finally came to America and I called, I was so excited. And she said, "Sister, you're going to come to my church?" And I said, "Of course." Because I told God, I said, "God, if you allow me to go to this America that Leslyn is talking about, I'm going to serve you for the rest of my life." And he allowed it. And when I was in the airplane, I heard the pilot said, "Welcome to America." And I cried and I said, "This is a beginning of a new life." And as I came to America, she took me to Restoration Temple. And Bishop John was my shepherd, he was my leader, he was my father. And I serve at Restoration Temple. And I grew. And my life changed. And it was all because of Leslyn. And oftentimes when we talk, and I would say something that she's not pleased about, she would say, "Sister Natalie, remember what your pastor say," and that's Paul B. Mitchell, "when people go low, you go high." And in question, when she passed, I was in my kitchen and I was so broken. And I felt her presence singing this song in my ear. And oftentimes at Restoration Temple, Bishop John would sing that song, and I didn't understand the depth of that song until Leslie passed. And the song is, I'm just going to say the chorus just because of time. And Sharon, my friend, if I cry, she's going to help me. And it says, thank you for giving to the Lord, for I was a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you thank you for giving to the Lord. For I was the life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. And I am so glad you did. And I thank God that she gave to the Lord, because I went to Restoration Temple. I accept the Lord. I give my life to him. And so that is why I can stand today and rejoice. Thank you.
Of Leslyn. Leslyn loved the finer things of life and often shared her enthusiasm for fashion. She dared to be different. She set a standard. She made a difference. She had a statement, and she had a signature. She did not mind taking anyone along for the ride throughout her journey with fashion, and I was on board. Mom reminded me Leslyn wanted to be a designer. Let me also add, she wanted to be a stylist. It was one of her dreams. Leslyn and I met through Beverly Flazer, and I'm truly thankful to God and Beverly for that introduction. Even though we were often seen together and known as the Three Musketeers, Leslyn and I bonded over fashion. She was my teacher, our children, and our home. I remember the first time I asked for advice on dressing. It was Bishop Cummings' birthday celebration. She asked what I had to wear. I told her, and she chose a white top and a black skirt. Leslie and I shared the same hairstylist and dressmaker because she introduced me to them. I remember the first time she came to my home, she gave me a compliment and then told me I needed to add color. I would not share what was in my mind, but I took her advice, and I love color now. I just love the way she would tilt her hair to the side and say, "Okay, Miss Dale, when we had our differences. We encourage each other. She would often remind me to pray about all my needs, and I mean all of them. I did not know that when she gave me those crystals, I was receiving my last gift. Talk shows, American Got Talent, Broadway, painting, dining out, were a few of the things that Leslyn and I shared. Leslyn was also a virtuous woman. She embodied the fruits of the Spirit and displayed them. I saw her love for God and how deep it was, that love that surpasses all knowledge. She knew the fullness of God, which allowed her to love self. That made it easy for her to love others. She had patience and was caring. I saw those two, especially when her husband David was sick, how she cared and loved him. She was a devoted wife. I also saw her caring when she helped me to understand what my children were going through during the time of our separation, because she experienced that. Those testing times and trial times, she would share, not complain, because there was joy, that joy that only comes from within. She always had a smile on her face. Leslyn was a peaceful person. She had a peace of God that only He can give. She was faithful to God, and she was a faithful friend. You heard the gentleness in her voice, never a harsh word, and oh my, her kindness. Whether she was confronting someone, comforting someone, consulting with them, or giving, her concern for others was immense. She had self-control. I have never seen her display anger. Selfishness was evident in the way she loved her children and parents unconditionally and cared for their well-being so effortlessly. I know that God's goodness and mercy has always been with her, even in time of sickness. Mother dear, as Beverly and I would fondly call her, it was truly a pleasure meeting you. I will miss you and love you. You love me, and I will always cherish our bond and memories.
Leslyn was my sister friend, someone who I loved and respected ever since our friendship began over 20 years ago. She was loving, caring, and kind, and always carried herself with dignity. My sister friend was very loyal and committed. First to God, she loved Him with all her heart. She was committed to her husband and supported the call of God on his life 100%. She loved her children, her parents, and family. And always had their best interests at heart. When my husband and I relocated, she would constantly check up on our youngest son, who remained in Brooklyn, and often brought him dinner or goodies to make sure he was okay. We are grateful to God for allowing her to be in our lives. I will always remember the happy times we shared, especially as three the hard way, Dale, myself, and Leslyn. Her last words to me were in a beautiful text last month. She wished me a happy birthday and declared God's blessings for my future. I pray that the Lord grants peace and comfort to her grieving husband, children, parents, sibling, and other family members. Farewell, my sister friend. I love you.
Good evening, everyone. First, I would like to extend my deepest condolences to the family. I have known Leslyn for the past 12 years. We met at the job at Dean Street Residence, where she was the house manager. Leslyn was very devoted to her job. She cared deeply for the individuals she served. She always tried to ensure the individuals' needs were met. Her care and considerations were not only reserved for the individuals, but for Dean Street staff and her fellow coworkers. Leslyn was kind, caring, and a loving fashionista. I'm going to miss our talks about work, personal matters, shopping, trying out the latest restaurants and what happened the night before on the Wendy Williams show. Whenever I asked Leslie for advice, she would always say, take it to the Lord in prayer. Her commitment to the job was secondary only to her devotion to the Lord and to her family. I was very lucky enough to work with Leslie and got a chance to see what a great woman she was. She'll be greatly missed. Thank you.
My grandma Leslie was always present, always. Every school play I was ever in, she showed up with the biggest smile and flowers. I looked forward to our just because visits, always with a treat for my sisters and I, always listening with interest to anything we had to say, then reminding us that her and grandpa were always praying for us and that she loved us, always present.
Grandma Leslie was a fashionista, a beauty, even on regular days. Whenever I complimented her style, I would hear her say, thank you, baby girl. I selfishly looked forward to gifts from her because I would have a part of her style in my closet. She always knew the perfect outfits for each of us. I just know she's showing some angels how to fashion their wings.
Grandma Leslie was a giver. My sisters and I never left her home empty-handed or hungry. Some of my favorite arts and crafts are from Grandma Leslie. Some of my favorite sweet treats also come from her. My favorite were cotton candy grapes. I think she sprinkled them with love because the ones she gave are the best ever.
We love you, Grandma Leslie.
We love you, Grandma Leslie.
We love you, Grandma Leslie.
See you in glory.
See you in glory.
Hallelujah. Amen. We thank God for the tributes, praise God, and for the reflections. Hallelujah. This time, we're going to be blessed with a beautiful dance with our sister Shannon Ishmael. Let's say amen.
I
give us the tribute. Amen.
Hallelujah. Good evening, everyone. I need your help, Holy Spirit.
Oh,
Hallelujah. We can praise him. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Because all our lives, he has been faithful. Bless God. We thank God for the beautiful tribute. Amen. For our sister, Monique Bethune Simon. Bless the Lord Jesus. Glory to God. At this time, we're going to be having the eulogy. Amen. And our sister Candace will be coming before us. In the name of Jesus. Let us say amen.
Everyone, this is extremely hard for me, so I kindly ask that you bear with me and keep me covered in God's grace so that I can get through this. Thank you, Jesus. On Sunday, October 4th, 1969, proud parents Clifford and Evelyn Clark were blessed with their firstborn, a beautiful baby girl, who you've all come to know and love as Leslyn. My brother and I had the honor and privilege of calling her Mommy. My mom was a pleasant child and a loving big sister who welcomed her siblings with open arms. She took great pride in the naming of her first brother, Mark. As a child, her hobbies were styling hair and arts and crafts, but she had an undeniable love for fashion which followed her through adulthood, as she was known for her unmatched sense of style. Words like classy, elegant, diva, and regal were often used to describe her unique fashion sense, which was an expression of her personality and individuality. My mother was a woman of few words, but her statement pieces spoke for her as she was guaranteed to be exquisitely dressed. She spent her early years in her hometown of Guyana and migrated to the United States at the tender age of 6. A natural-born scholar, she made her way through New York City's public school system with ease. Her elementary journey began at PS 235, followed by Winthrop for junior high school, and continued to John Dewey, where she received her high school diploma. Her quest for higher knowledge and desire to secure a brighter future led her to attend Touro College for her secondary education. But it was her generous heart and passion for helping others that led her to find employment with New York State Office for People with Developmental Disabilities. My mom held various positions and titles during her three decades at DDSO, most recently as manager. She will be remembered by her colleagues as one of the most involved, generous, and forward-thinking managers they've ever had. Mommy was a soft-spoken, patient woman. Her warm spirit and generous heart could be felt by anyone she encountered. She was selfless and put the needs of others before her own. She was fun-loving, outgoing, and vivacious. Simply put, she loved life. She was an avid lover of nice things, especially in her home. Whether it was in her kitchen preparing her famous fried rice, lo mein, lasagna, split peas and rice, or adding constant finishing touches to her already well-decorated home, she enjoyed the beauty and satisfaction it encompassed. Family and friends alike can testify. When visiting your home, she was never empty-handed. You would be blessed with a sweet treat, a jug of sorrow, something to beautify your home, or sound advice on any number of things, truly embodying living in love. My mother's love for cooking and fashion was only surpassed by the love she had for her children, myself and my brother, Kenton. She was a wonderful mother, and despite whatever she was going through, she always wore a smile and taught us to make Christ the center of our lives. Mommy loved the Lord and served him with her whole heart. She fellowshipped at Restoration Temple Assemblies of God, where she served in the hospitality department, and was an active member of the intercessory prayer group. It is there that she met her husband, Pastor David Ross. The two were joined in marriage on December 5th, 2003. Mom embraced dad's children, Monique deceased, Edson and Candace as her own. She also embraced her role as Grandma Leslin. She eventually transitioned from Restoration Temple and joined Change in Life Christian Center, making it her resident church, where she also served as an intercessor. My mom is survived by myself and my brother, her husband David, my grandparents Clifford and Evelyn, her siblings Nicole, Mark, and Edgar, children in love Edson and Candace, daughter-in-law Dawn, nieces and nephews Natalie, Erica, and Tafari, grandchildren in love, and a host of family, friends, and loved ones. I celebrate my mom's life with you today, and I kindly ask that when you think of her, celebrate the good memories you have of her. She'd want you to remember that life is fragile and short, and she be lived to the fullest. She will be missed more than any words I could ever try to express. But she will forever be in my heart, as well as in yours, until we meet her again. Sleep in eternal peace, Mommy. I love you. Thank you.
Hallelujah. We thank God, amen, for the description of a beautiful life. Amen. And for our sister Leslin Ross. Thank you, Sister Candace. Amen. I want to remind you, amen, that if you don't have a program, that there is a SKU at the back. You can scan the QR code in the lobby with your phone, and you can receive a keepsake there to keep forever. So, amen. It's in the back in the lobby. When you go out, you'll see that you can scan the code, the QR code in the lobby. Amen. Well, at this time, praise the Lord, we're going to be receiving, amen, the angel of this church, amen, to bring forth, amen, the sermon of tonight. So I'm just going to ask you to stand and welcome, amen, Pastor Paul B. Mitchell.
Amen. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Thank you, Pastor Clark. On behalf of Pastor Yasmin and I, my wife, and the entire Changing Lives Christian Center Church family, we bring condolences to the family, and our hearts are with you. We're praying for you, and we will continue to pray for you individually and corporately. Amen. Sister Leslin Ross, are you going to let me be myself tonight? Okay. What can I say about the Ross family that probably has not already been said? Phenomenal group of people. Pastor and Sister Ross, they are a staple in this church. Now, don't minimize that, because every pastor under the sound of my voice will tell you that you cannot have a successful ministry without having people who have your back. You have to have people who refuse to let you fail. It has nothing to do with exegetical abilities. Makes no difference how well you can preach and philosophize and philosophically deduce and reason scriptures and come out with analytical deductions to critical thinking. Makes no difference how much conceptualizations you know and ideologies you know. You cannot build a ministry without committed people. And we as pastors, Pastor Ross, Pastor Clark, the pastors here with us and the pastors in the building, they all know what I'm talking about. It has nothing to do with giftings. It has nothing to do with how wonderful you are. It has everything to do with one word, God's grace. And so she's going to be sorely missed by my wife and I and this church family. I cannot say that my heart is not torn. My wife and I, we've spoken to her while she was in the hospital. She called and we spoke and prayed, and I gave her scriptures to read, and she could hardly talk. And I know what it was like to hang up the phone and say, God, you have to do something. Ever negotiate with God and try to tell God what he's supposed to do? I know I'm the only one in here that's done that. You pray for the preacher. But at the end of the day, we all have to say, not my will, but thy will be done. If you have a Bible, I want to go to the word of the Lord this morning. And tonight, I should say. I'm thinking about tomorrow morning already. If you have a Bible, I'm in Mark chapter 5. And I'm going to read a very familiar story. I'll paraphrase a little bit and then jump into what I have to talk about tonight. Amen. In spite of everything, I want to tell everybody under the sound of my voice that God is good. Amen. And while we don't know and understand everything, he knows and understands everything. Just see with me tonight. Let me just talk to you for a little while. In Mark chapter 5, verse 21, the Bible says, and when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one, the ruler of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. The story goes on to say that on the way, Jesus was interrupted by a woman with an issue of blood. He dealt with that matter. And the story picks up in verse 35. The Bible says, while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. There's revelation in that, because faith cometh by hearing, but fear comes by hearing too. Verse 37 says, and he suffered no man to follow him save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn, but when he had put them all out. How many people know that sometimes you have to put people out? When you are in faith for something, there's just some folks you have to put out. I could scratch that further. He taketh the father and the mother of the damsel and them that were with him, and entered into where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha Kumai, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12. God never says anything arbitrarily. If it's not important, he doesn't say anything about it. The fact that the word indicates that she was 12 years old means something. The number 12 means the government of God. That means the government was about to go to work. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. Can you say amen? Amen. Very interesting story, very familiar passage of scripture. The subject that I picked was taken from two things presented to us in just opposition. The messenger says to Jairus, your daughter is dead. Jesus comes on the scene and says, she's not dead, she's just asleep. So the question I have for you tonight is Leslyn dead or did she just die? This is a very interesting story because it speaks to us about perspective. In this story, the Lord showed me something about perspective and how important it is. I'm going to talk to you from the conversation or the topic, dead or died. Dead or died. And I'm going to talk about four things, four bullet points, four concepts, four things to consider. I'm going to talk about, number one, the story. And then number two, I'm going to talk to you about some definitions. Then thirdly, I'm going to talk about the difference. And then fourthly, and finally, the most importantly, the decisions we have to make. So the Bible says that this ruler or religious leader had a 12-year-old daughter who became very ill. The Bible says that he comes to Jesus and says, my daughter's at the point of death. Would you come to the house and heal her? Jesus says, I'll come. On the way, Jesus is interrupted by a woman with an issue of blood for 12 years. He deals with the woman with the issue of blood. When he is finished with that, he continues on his journey, and on his way to Jairus' house, one of Jairus' servants come running and said, don't trouble the master any longer. Your daughter is dead. Jesus looks at Jairus and said, don't be afraid, only believe. So they went to the house, and when Jesus saw the girl, he made a very strange statement. He says, she's not dead, she's just asleep. So I want to ask the question again. Was the little girl dead, or did the little girl die? Is there a difference? Is there a difference? Is there a difference between dead, died, deceased, asleep? Is there a difference? The messenger that came said that she was dead, and it's obvious by the reaction of the people that was present that she was indeed dead. But Jesus, looking at the same scenario, said that she was not dead, but rather asleep. The word sleep is a figure of speech commonly used of death in the New Testament. So what Jesus is saying here is she is not dead, her body is just asleep. Jesus is saying she's not dead, she just died. Now, I want to ask you a question. Is Sister Ross dead, or did she just die? Are we dealing with semantics? Are we in denial? Well, let's use me. Am I dealing with semantics? And am I dealing with denial? Or am I just dealing with a play on word? Am I just saying the same thing a different way? Is there indeed a difference between saying someone is dead and saying someone died? Now, this is important now, because now if there is no difference between dead or died, Jesus' statement seems a little off. So let's talk definition for just a moment, because I gave you four bullet points and I said I would talk definitions. So let's talk definitions for just a moment. Let's examine these two words. The word dead means having lost life. It means lifeless. It means no longer alive. It means no longer in existence. So if a person is dead, they are no longer alive. If a person is dead, they are no longer in existence. The word dead is an adjective, isn't it? Talk back to me. An adjective describes a state of being or position. To say someone is dead, that's an adjective. It describes a state of being or position. Now, let's look at the other word, died. Now, the word died is a verb. It's an action word. It's an act. It's an act of separation, and it's an act of departure. How do we know that? Well, James 2:26 says that death is an act of separation. James also says that death is the separation of the spirit from the body. That's all it is. Jesus now is speaking from the vantage point of the spiritual. Jesus is viewing the same body that they were looking at. But Jesus knew that body was not really her. And all death is just the separation of spirit from the body. That's what James says. Now, the word died also is an act of departure. Say departure. 2 Timothy 4:6, Paul says, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand." So to say someone died, that is an act of departure. I'm certain that some of you came from out of town, and I'm certain that some of you came from somewhere else. Well, you simply departed from wherever you were, and now you are here. Stay with me. Look at your neighbor and say, "That's all death is." Death is nothing more than a departure. You departed from wherever you were, and now you are here. And when I'm finished preaching tonight, we're all going to depart again, and we will all be somewhere else.
So when we say someone died, it is no more than just an act. It is an act of separation. It's an act of departure. Now someone says, what difference does it make to say that someone died or someone is dead? Well, it's a tremendous difference, not only to Sister Ross, but for you and I. Amen. Now listen, if Sister Ross is dead, then she is no longer in existence. If Sister Ross is dead, then she is nowhere. And I want to just pause here for 5 seconds and tell everybody under the sound of my voice, look at Pastor. There'll never be a time when you are nowhere. There'll never be a time when you are nowhere. Mm-hmm. Okay, praise the Lord. Now, that's a terrible place to be, isn't it? It's a terrible place to be in your thinking, because Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. What Paul is saying is that if life is just about living here and then we die, we are nowhere. We no longer exist. Paul says that would be a miserable, terrible, awful life. Paul says that would be tragic. It would be a shame for Sister Ross to live the life that she lived, serve God the way she served God, loved her family the way she loved her family, loved her church and her friends the way she loved them, and then died and be nowhere. It would have been a waste of time to serve God's people, serve God's agenda, serve God's church, serve her family and friends, and then die and be nowhere. The devil is a liar. I'll talk to some people tonight. But if she died, all that means is that she departed. And this means she's somewhere else, just not here. This is what I came to tell you. I came to tell you that she's not dead. She's not dead. She's not dead. Let me go to this side, because this side is looking at me like I got a third eye right here. So maybe this is the friendly side over here. I don't know. She's not dead. Wake up the rest of these folks sleeping up in here. Bump somebody and tell them, she's not dead. She's not dead. Some of you didn't touch anybody because you're not feeling the preacher yet, but just sit there. I'm coming for you. I'll ring your doorbell in a few more moments. But until I ring it, would you bump somebody else and tell them she's not dead? She just died. It's a verb. It's an action word. It's an act. It's an act of separation. It's just an act of departure. This means she's somewhere else, just not here. And this is what Paul was talking about in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 8. When he says to be absent from the body is to be. You don't hear me yet. You're not feeling me right here. But to be absent from the body is to be. But to be absent from the body is, Pastor V, to be. Not nowhere. But to be. But to be absent from the body is to be. Not nowhere. To be somewhere else. To be present with the Lord. In other words, to be in God's presence. I'm winding down to a close. But I want to put my eyes on 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And it says in verse 8, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore, Paul says, we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or evil. We talked about four bullet points, didn't we? We said we're going to talk about the story. Then we're going to talk about some definitions. And now we're talking about the difference. Now I want to talk to you about the decision as I hurry to a close. 2 Timothy chapter 4. Thank you, Jesus. And verse 6 says, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. When I teach my leadership class on Sunday mornings, I teach the leaders of my church, don't you get nervous about who comes and who goes. Because pastor doesn't get paid for who comes and goes. Every pastor gets paid for finishing their course. We can't determine who rides the bus. If you ring the door, if you ring the bell on a bus, the bus driver is going to pull over and let your saved self off. And when he's finished letting your saved self off with your Bible, he's going to pull off from you and your Bible and finish. Okay, all right. We're just talking. Paul says, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody in here excited about a crown of righteousness? That's for Christian service. What you did. That's what Leslie did in her church. That's what she did in the body of Christ. The Bible says, henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Somebody said, Pastor, we're sad. We're all sad. But truth be told, if we could talk to Leslie on the phone and ask her to come back, she said she would say, all of you are mad. Love you, but I'll see you when you arrive, or not. I have to throw that in to be accurate. Now the decision. Here's my last bullet point, then I'm going to wrap up. And in my quiet time, I asked the Lord which closing to use, because I have two of them. So I wrote them both down, and I said, Lord, when I get there, you tell me which one. And he's told me which one. Now I want to talk to you about the decision. I could talk to you about the fact that we shouldn't be too sad because it's just a departure and we will see her again. For the Bible says, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall arise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. So there's a reunion coming. But I'm not talking about that. Because I can scratch that for the next 15 minutes and close this out. Here's what God wants me to tell some of you, because some of you outside of Leslie's death will not set foot inside God's house. And I'm suspicious of God. Every time he makes a decision, it cuts one way, but then it cuts another way. And I'm suspicious that the reason we're all here, I'm suspicious that Leslie's death is the pediatrics of why we're here. Because Hebrews says, and as it is appointed unto men, once to die. You know you're going to die. You know everybody's going to die. You're not shocked that people die. We're sad, but we're not shocked. But the Bible says, as it is appointed unto men once to die, and then after that, the judgment. Now, I want to scratch this for 5 minutes and then shut this down. I want to tell all of you under the sound of my voice that think that church is ridiculous and salvation and knowing Jesus is ridiculous, I want to tell you something. I love you. I appreciate you. I know you didn't come to be insulted. I'm not going to insult you, but you are out. Where are my members at? Are my members here? Raise your hands towards me. Hurry up. Go ahead. Do it. Say it. As it is appointed unto men once to die, and then after that, the judgment. The judgment simply means the decision. Judgment for the plaintiff. Judgment for the defendant. It is simply a decision. The question I want to ask you is this. Do you know that you have a divine appointment to go here? According to Hebrews chapter 9, 27, as it is appointed unto men, appointed unto men once to die, and then after that, a decision is going to be made. And I want to tell you something about that appointment. You can't cancel it. And you can't reschedule it. And you cannot email God and say, I can't make it. And you can turn your nose up at God on the earth, but eventually you will stand. I'm amazed at folks who live their whole life as if there's no eternity. And they don't understand that life is this. Here. Your mama's womb, you come out bawling. You live for some years, and then you're gone. And we do everything in the world with this. From here to here. And nobody tells us that this is coming, eternity. We act like nothing is coming. It's just this. No. It's not just this. There's more. You gonna help me preach as I close? Bump your neighbor and tell him there's more coming. I know some of you are not gonna do that. Some of you are not gonna do that because you don't want to hear that. But the Bible says it's appointed unto men once to die. See, I gotta talk to sinners. This is the decision, my fourth point. I'm a poor pastor. My calling is not authentic if I don't talk to the lost. As it is appointed unto men once to die, and then after that, the decision, the judgment. Somebody said, well, God will never send, a loving God will never send people to hell. God is not going to send anybody to hell, just like the judge doesn't sentence anybody to jail. It's not the judge putting the individual in jail. It's what the person did. As is appointed unto men once to die, and then after that, the judgment. I want to tell everybody under the sound of my voice, you have a divine appointment, and you're going to make that appointment whether you like it or not. And this pastor came to tell you, and take a good look at me, because when you stand before God, you're going to say, God, I didn't know, I didn't hear. God's going to roll the tape. It's going to come. So remember that guy right there? He told you you had a divine appointment. And he told you to get your life in order, because all of us are going to pass this way. It's just a matter of the clock ticking. And he's going to say to you, how come you didn't fix it while you were there? And you're not going to be able to say, I didn't know, because my assignment is to tell you. You have a divine appointment. And when you have an appointment for a job interview, don't you get ready? Don't you get another suit? Don't you get a tie that matched? Don't you shower and shave and get your portfolio together and get your business and things in order? Why? Because we have an appointment, and that we must prepare for. It's foolish to live your whole life as if you have no appointment. And you go to funeral after funeral after funeral after funeral, and you just know you have an appointment, and you do absolutely nothing about it. Now, somebody said, well, does it mean I have to get saved and come to the church and no more fun? You can still have fun. Y'all better pray for me, because when I start teaching, things come up on my computer screen in my head, and I have to delete what I don't want to say. Part of the problem why people don't want God is the church. Because we made the church so ridiculous. Well, we can't do this, and we can't wear that, and we can't do that. And folks say, if that's what it takes for God, I just die and go to hell. But the devil is a liar. You don't have to get good to get God. Get God, and then God will help you. You want to let me finish? Here's what I say at almost every funeral. Get in the gospel car. Get in the car. But preacher, I still drink. Drink in the car. Pastor, I still smoke a little bit every now and then. I still like, the plant. Do it in the car. Just not outside after church. Pastor, I still cuss a little. What, cuss? You don't want me. You don't want me. This is too real for some of you. You're not used to that type of conversation from a preacher. Do it in the car. I still lie sometimes. Lie in. because I still get angry. Get angry in the car and let God drive you all the way home to glory. Listen to me, I gotta close. As you walk with God, stop judging the church and stop judging church people. Stop thinking that we're perfect. None of us are perfect. There is no perfection in the flesh. All of us need Jesus for something. Stop saying I'm gonna get better first and then I'm gonna get right, Pastor. No, get right first. And as you walk on with God, as you walk with God, as you walk with God, as you walk with God, Pastor, will I stop smoking? You will eventually, but not right away. You'll just smoke less. And as you walk with God, you'll smoke less and cuss less and lie less and cheat less and do everything. And over time, one day you'll look behind you and say, you know, I haven't even done that. I haven't done that in a long time. That's how it works. Now I got to send you home. Touch five people. Tell them, get in the car. Don't let anybody escape. Don't let anybody get away. Don't let anybody turn you away. Touch five people. Tell them, get in the car. Get in the car. Because if God can stand the smell of smoke, God can withstand lying. You're not shocking God with your behavior. He's seen everything. He knows your frame. He knows what you're made out of. He knows your strengths and your weaknesses, your shortcomings, your inconsistencies, your idiosyncrasies. He knows everything about you. You learning about yourself. God already knows you. So Leslyn, she died. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Leslyn is not dead. She just died. And it is appointed unto men once to die. She's nowhere. She's just not here. But she's somewhere. Setting up to get her a reward with her cute self. I don't know a whole lot of things, but I'll tell you one thing. Pastor Ross, he got some taste. My wife and I was out on a date night on a Friday night, and we were in Manhattan, and we run into Pastor Ross and his wife, and we greeted each other in passing. I guess he was out on a date too. And after he walked off and my wife and I went our separate ways, we just looked at each other and said, that's a good-looking woman. That boy got taste. There's a number of preachers up here. Have you ever felt like you messed up a sermon? Touch two more people and tell them, Leslyn's not dead, she just died. Come on, touch two more people, tell them, Leslyn's not dead, she just died. She just died. She's home with Dad, the creator of all spirits, preparing to get her reward. And although we will miss her on this side, because as a pastor, I know it takes good people. It's not us, y'all. It's the people. It takes good people. And although we're sad on this side, we know that she's in a much better place. She's on the other side preparing to receive her reward. And I want to encourage you, prepare.
prepare yourself to receive your reward.
Bless the Lord. Amen. We thank God, hallelujah, for the angel of this church. We thank God for, amen, our pastor, Paul B. Mitchell, and for that blessed sermon in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. At this time, amen, we're going to be receiving Bishop John Cummings to give us a prayer of comfort in Jesus' name.
Want to give God thanks for such a poignant word. And I trust that none of you who are not saved would be lost after this word. I want you to stand with me and let's just pray right now. Heavenly Father, we can find reason to rejoice tonight because our beloved sister is somewhere. She's with you. We want to thank you, dear God, that you were with her in her journey here on earth. And as she departed this earth, you took her safely into your arms, into your bosom. And now I pray tonight for all the family who mourn. I thank you that we have a promise from you that blessed are they that mourn, they shall be comforted. Let the comforter come now, my God. Let the comforter come and touch the family. Touch every heart. Touch the grieving hearts. Lord, we want to thank you that we can express our empathy with our presence, but you can touch them by your Spirit and cause them to have the peace that passeth all understanding. I pray, dear God, that each will receive strength to continue this journey until you summon them home. I pray, dear God, for everyone in this house today, that in this moment we will feel the touch of your presence that speaks comfort. God, thank you for letting Leslyn bless our lives. Thank you, dear God, that she has left us with pleasant memories, reasons to live fully and to live for you. And thank you, dear God, for this day. We praise you now because we can rely on you. In Jesus' name, amen. And God bless you all.
Amen. We thank God for our bishop, praise the Lord, and for the prayer that's gone up before the Lord. Just want to let you know that on tomorrow at 10:30, amen, we'll be gathered here and proceeding to Cypress Hills Cemetery in the morning, praise God. So all are invited to come out, if you can, amen, to bid farewell. in the name of Jesus. Then thereafter, the repast will be at Grace Cathedral, which is right across the street. And if you wish to come, amen, the family wants to welcome you in Jesus' name. We want to thank God for each one that has come out tonight. Hallelujah. In behalf of the family, we're just so grateful, amen, for you just showing your respect and your honor in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. So we're going to dismiss at this time, and we pray for your safe journey home, traveling mercies, amen, until we see each other one more time, in Jesus' name.
All right, let me also add this. The family, I want to honor the family completely, totally. They've asked us to do, if we could do a final viewing of the body. So for those of you that would like to view the body, you've not had an opportunity as of yet to view the body, I'm going to ask you to make one line for me, please. Now, it's a full house. Upstairs is full, and there's a lot of people in the lobby. Simply make one line to my left, to your right. Stand right there and wait for me. And then our ushers will give you instructions as the pallbearers, as the funeral home directors would come and make the body available for visual. Make one line to my left and to your right if you desire to view the body. Amen. God bless you. Tomorrow morning, 10:30, the body will be leaving here, going to Cyprus. Amen.